Everyone, my name is Michelle Demers, and I'm creator of Power 15 Clubs. I help people work on their goals every single day, and I'm so excited to collaborate with Clancy Cox. Clancy is a soprano, a voice teacher, and she's the creator of the Vocal Alchemy Club. And together, we're helping people who want to sing and study voice and do anything with their voice to get daily practice and perfecting their voices, among other things that we do in the club. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. But Clancy, I know today our goal for this conversation is to talk more about your upcoming college workshop, helping students before, during, and after college years really navigate their education and working towards a career in music, whatever that might look like for them.
Yes, and there are so many different paths that you can take towards a vocal career. So I created a workshop that will enlighten pre-college and college-age singers to understand a lot of the issues that they're facing and hopefully give some clarity and perspective so that they can make better decisions for themselves. So I often find myself thinking about the things I wish I had known 20 years ago. And really at that time, I didn't know that I would have benefited so much from a mentor that had a lot of perspective. And so now I'm the mentor who I really want to help younger singers navigate decisions, because it feels to me like young singers are expected to make these decisions that affect their life, but they don't have the necessary facts to make good decisions for them. So one decision might be the best thing for one singer and really the wrong thing for a different kind of singer with different goals.
I know the purpose of this workshop or going over some of the topics we're going to talk about today, but a lot of what you do on the workshop is create a lot of dialogue and conversation so that you can answer questions and really dig into what the students' needs are, what questions are coming up for them. So there's real value in people going to the workshop because you get to speak with you.
Yes.
Those questions that either they don't know to ask yet or the ones that are on their mind and they're just not knowing where to find the answers. So
yes, and so many of the questions we don't know how to ask yet, because our goals, we have a sense of our goals, but putting them into words and asking someone who's been in the game for a couple decades, it's really a priceless opportunity.
Right. Oh, exactly. Well, I'm really excited to dig into some of these key topics today. I mean, first and foremost, you can't escape the fact that college is a huge investment and expense. And one of the things we're going to talk about today is that college isn't the only path. But let's talk about, you know, for somebody who either isn't in college yet and they're considering going down that road of going to college, or maybe a student who already is in college and they're wondering, you know, are they getting the most out of that investment? Can you speak to that? Like, how would somebody know that that's a good investment for them?
Yes. Well, one of the important things, I think, is to know what you're going for. Do you just love to sing and you've got great reactions from your singing and you're really thinking, I want to perform for my career, I just have to do it? Are you thinking that you love working with other people, that you love teaching? Are you thinking of becoming a music teacher? Are you more interested in the music business side of things? When I was applying to schools, there were only 4 music business degrees available in the country that I could find, that I knew of. Maybe there were more, but I could only find four major ones. Now there are dozens. So it really depends on what your interests are and finding some clarity on that. So if your goal is to become a music teacher in the public schools, elementary or high school, you really will need a certificate and a degree. So going to school is a really good option for you. If you are a performance, if your heart is just saying you need to be on stage, again, it depends what type of voice you have. If you are thinking opera, you probably do need to go to school. You need to follow that academic path. If you are thinking pop, just I defy you to find a pop star who finished college. It's hard to do. I've done some of my own research because it really is just more about jumping in there and your life experience. So it depends for the pre-college singer. It depends what is calling to your heart and doing some deep thinking about that. So I have some questions, clarifying questions that I ask so that students and singers can start thinking about what they want.
Right. So not every career path requires a degree, but then there's also other reasons to go to college. And I know you dig more into that in your workshop.
Yes. Yes, indeed.
Let's talk about the glaring issue that's coming up for everybody right now, which is COVID-19. And the fact that a lot of colleges are now doing everything virtual or hybrid, and the performance aspect, the being on campus, is so important for singers and people pursuing music. So, you know, what are your thoughts on how that's factoring into that decision on whether somebody goes to college or not right now?
Yes, yes. So as many people considering college can see, the cost of college is rising. It's rising so much faster than the average salary of a person who goes to college. So that's one thing to think of.
Nancy, can you give some numbers just so people kind of understand, like, a range someone might be expecting to pay?
Sure. So just tuition of where I live in New York, the SUNY schools, just tuition is about $12,000 a year. So you have to figure in living expenses and room and board, all of that stuff. Private colleges can be $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 a year. So, and that does not include your living expenses. So it's, and it becomes astronomical. Some of the graduate programs that I've looked at are about $60,000 a year or more. So cost of college is no joke. You can get scholarships. I have a lot of ideas, a lot of wisdom to share about how to go for scholarships, how to apply for grants and things like that. So it is possible, and I don't want to dissuade anyone from trying. There are also some schools where if you are talented enough and lucky enough to be accepted, tuition is free due to a huge grant or, you know, somebody left millions of dollars in their will to a particular school. So that's something to think about too. And if you can go to school for free, I would say, as long as you know how to protect your voice and find the right voice teacher, go, you know. But I do not advise getting hundreds of thousands of dollars into debt. I just don't advise that. It's a really tough place to be to start your career and have student loans that you can't afford to pay. I don't want to see anyone in that position.
Yeah, right. And as you'll mention in the workshop, and we'll touch on just briefly later, there's alternatives to that as well. So it doesn't really mean you have to go down that path to achieve the career of your dreams. But yeah, I mean, even on the low end, when you're talking $12,000 times four, you know, we're talking about $50,000, and then we're not including living expenses. So even in the kind of the least expensive route, you know, somebody could be looking at $50,000 to $100,000 in either paying out of pocket, some type of financial aid, loans, or hopefully, as you were saying, scholarships and grants. But on the higher end, it's $400,000 can actually be the bill at the end of the day when everything's factored in. So it's a huge investment.
Right. And especially for performance, it's not just undergrad, right? You're then going to go for young artist programs. Some of them pay you a tiny stipend. Some of them, you have to front the costs of a new place to live and all of those living expenses. So especially in the operatic world, you will be expected to pay as you build your experience. And you will probably be expected to go to graduate school, maybe even get a PhD. So it's not like, oh, these 4 years and then I'm all set. So I just want people to start to broaden their perspective and understand the stamina that they will have to find, you know, the fortitude and stamina they will have to find and display. And it's hard to do it on your own. It becomes a whole family support system. So that's why I hope the parents are watching too.
Absolutely. Let's touch back on COVID real quick. And do you think that it's possible for students to get the quality education and instruction that they need virtually, which is how so many students are going to school right now? Or do you think, and I know you go into this in more detail, so you just give some top of mind ideas right now, or do you think, you know, it's worth pausing or taking a break or do something else at this time? And how would a student know which way is right for them?
Oh, those are really good questions. And I'm sure a lot of people are struggling with these questions because there's this pressure, you know, here's the audition date, here's the time you need to have your application in. And students may find themselves wondering, well, what's it really gonna be like? You know, when most, if not all of your classes are online, the question that comes to my mind is, why am I paying for an in-person experience when I'm getting online? Now, some students will thrive in the online scenario. You have to really think about yourself. Are you okay with this much screen time? Also, with music, part of the benefit of undergrad is you're making connections with other students. You're learning to harmonize. You're tuning your ear. You're working on ear training skills. You can't really do that and get the full benefit if you're online. Part of the huge benefit and reasons that I am glad that I got to go to school was being in the school choirs, you know, kind of working my way up every semester until I could get into the top level school choir, and what that did for my musicianship, you know, what it does for your rhythm, for your unspoken communication with other musicians. I don't think that part, which is very important to me, I don't think that part is possible during COVID when you're online and you have the latency. So some schools, I think that some conservatories are investing big bucks in the in new software and things like that, so that the pianist can be in one room, the voice singer can be in the other room, and there's no latency. So it is something to explore, but most schools are not going to be investing in that software. And so you've got to really ask those questions of the schools you're considering. How are you handling this? Am I getting an online education? Or, you know, will I be able to improve my musicianship in person? And how do we do that safely?
Right. Two quick things I want to touch on with that, and then we can move on. One is, So we're recording this video January 2021. We know a vaccine's coming out, but still there's so much unknown. And it's still possible that even this time next year, we're still going to be dealing with the pandemic. So in my mind, it's probably going to be a couple of years before we're back to, quote, normal on college campuses. And so there is this amount of time for students to navigate on making these decisions. And maybe you can just quickly touch on, and we'll get into this in more detail later, and also in your workshop you talk about this, but you've been developing an online program. So to the degree that you can support students in an online environment, can you just quickly talk about, I know you were saying you missed some of the live in-person performance aspects, but students can get pretty far in an online environment with the proper teacher and instruction. So maybe just quickly touch on, you know, the fact that it's not all or nothing, like what can they get out of an online experience?
Oh, sure. Well, yeah. So I personally did take not one, but 2 years between high school and college. Mm-hmm. To myself, I was telling myself, you know, and when people would say, why aren't you going to college? What are you doing? I would say, well, I'm earning money working in my parents' bakery, and I'm taking voice lessons to strengthen my voice, and I'm preparing my audition pieces. So there are so many things that you can do on your own so that you are coming into school at a higher level, and you're preparing yourself for opportunities that might come your way. So learning pieces, you know, you can do that with a teacher one-on-one, you know, via Zoom. There are other applications that are really working on sound, you know, getting the sound better. So yeah, learning your pieces, learning IPA, which is International Phonetic Alphabet. So really working on your pronunciation, working on your range, working on your technique. All of these things are things that you can work on with a teacher online. And I have developed a program that is going to help singers develop them, their habits, their artistic habits, because no matter how successful you are, there are things, just a baseline of professional habits that you need to develop. So you've got to discover the best process for you to learn a song quickly, accurately, expressively. You've got to learn how to tell a story, because the best singers are the best storytellers, in my opinion. I mean, you can probably think of people who don't have a technically beautiful voice, but you listen to them because the way they tell the story is so compelling. So these are all things that an artist really can work on, you know, whether they're in school or not. So those are the things that I was trying to work on in my years between high school and college.
And actually the fact that, you know, that was 20 years ago that you were in school, and now we are in the world of online and Zoom and all of that. And even you and I have talked about putting together some online recitals and performance opportunities, even in an online environment. So there is still a lot of value in things that you can do online, either in the meantime, between, if you do take some time off of college because of COVID or another reason, or whether you choose not to go to college too, you can get really far through a hybrid of working online with someone like yourself, and then, you know, looking for local opportunities for performance aspects. So those are all great points, Clancy. One of the things in my conversations with you that in getting to know you that I was just shocked by is I know that you talked about the fact that so many people in your music world and sphere came out of school with voices that were too damaged to actually pursue a professional career. And I think that's something that students at any level need to know, that, you know, whether it's college or whether they're in some other vocal program or something, that they need to protect their voice. Can you talk about that? Because I think that you know, that's just something everyone should know regardless of what path they take.
Yes, it seems counterintuitive, doesn't it? That someone can be talented enough to get into school, hardworking enough that they get through, they jump through all the hoops, they meet the requirements. And at the end of 4 years, their voice is in a worse place than they began. I see that more often than I would, than should happen. It's heartbreaking to me. I think there's a lot of reasons for it. In our culture, it's like whoever shouts the loudest wins, you know, in many ways. I think that that has transferred to our singing, where there is an unnatural amount of pressing. There's a lot of tension. There's a lot of creating volume through muscular tension and pushing. And it's not my philosophy of how a young person especially should learn how to sing. There are ways to belt, I think, that are healthy, but many singers do not have access to a teacher who is helping them that way. There's also a lot of stress during performance weeks that I think many singers are not taught how to deal with. We're not taught how to take care of ourselves, partly because the anatomy is so intricate. And I mean, it's just wild. It's a wild system that you cannot see, right? So you cannot see when you're doing damage. And there can
sometimes sometimes you can't feel it either. Like you can be going on for years and it's more after the fact that you realize that damage is done, right?
Yes. And it's not just singing. I know so many teachers who develop nodes or develop vocal problems because they're speaking all day long, but they may have a couple habits that are compromising the health of their vocal folds. So there is so much that a young singer can learn to do technique-wise, but also just checking in with their bodies. My philosophy is that singing should feel good. And if it doesn't feel good, if you feel tension, if you feel dryness, tiredness, soreness, that's something that needs to be addressed. It's better to stop, figure out what's going on. Many of the pre-college singers, they may be fortunate enough to have a choir director, a voice teacher who understands developmentally how to guide a voice to grow in a developmentally appropriate way. The larynx is one of the last things to develop, the last organs to develop in the human body. So not till we're about 25 are you even fully developed. So if you have people who are pushing your voice, who are not recognizing that you're experiencing vocal problems, vocal fatigue, it's hard to drop those habits once they have developed. So choice of voice teacher and choice of someone who really understands how the anatomy develops is so important, I think.
And that's such a value in working with somebody like you, because you're going to see, even just by the way the student's holding their jaw or the tension in their throat, that you can bring attention to that. And so you will help them retrain themselves into better form and technique that won't strain. But I'm also thinking, you know, even if somebody is going the college path and they have professors and music teachers at college, if they're also working with you, like we'll talk about in a little bit, like in your college mentoring program, you'll be able to see, oh, you know, you're straining here when you're in school, when you're working on that piece with your teacher, make this adjustment and it's going to protect you. So kind of working with that student in tandem and helping them, you're going to help preserve their voice.
Yes. Yes. I'm really passionate about that because you don't want your career to be over before it started because you didn't listen to your body. You didn't listen to when things were strained and you didn't know how, or you didn't have the resources to drop the habits that will eventually they compound, you know? And once a singer has felt that the ease and joy of singing with their real voice, not something else that they're trying to sound like, but their real voice. Once you've discovered that, that pushing and unhealthy volume, it does lose its appeal a little bit. So I hope so. I know that it is seductive to sing with a big loud voice and impress people. I do understand that, but the voice does have to be approached with longevity in mind.
Yeah, that's so important. And you touched on something about the importance of choosing your music teacher. And I want to touch on two aspects of that. One is, how would a student even know before they started working with a music teacher if that music teacher is aware of or buys into those same philosophies as you are and can do that training the right way? And secondly, we'll talk about how it's important to choose the teacher even more than the college, if college is the path that they're going. So can you touch on both of those points?
Yes. This choose the teacher, not the college. This is one of the most important things that you can take away from this interview, and also the workshop. We'll delve into it more in the workshop about how you actually contact the teachers, how you set up lessons. I am an advocate for taking a sampling of lessons with many different teachers. Sometimes, depending on where you live, you may have a teacher and you just stay with that teacher for years and years. And hopefully that was a good teacher who didn't harm your voice. But there are so many teachers, so many different styles of teaching. I think that most voice teachers are going to have the same, you're going to be taught the same things, but one person might say it in a particular way that you really get it. And of course, like I said before, you want someone who's aware of how the voice develops and is not pushing you into roles or a form of singing before you're ready. So my best piece of advice for pre-college singers is, of course, you've got to start somewhere. So maybe location-wise, think about where you want to go to school. But don't just choose the school for the name of the school. Really look at the faculty. Write them an email or leave them a message. If they don't get back to you, that might be a clue that they're too busy. And do you think they're going to be less busy for you if you're placed in their studio? I don't know. You want someone who's going to be accessible enough to reach back out to you. You want to have at least one voice lesson with lots of different teachers who are available at the different schools that you're considering. Mm-hmm. And I can help you develop a list of questions, because one thing it's hard to know as a young singer is that the school and the voice teacher needs you just as much as you need them. And so you are interviewing them. It's, you know, do you feel a heart connection? Do you feel like they want the best for you? There are a lot of teachers who are wonderful singers, but it doesn't convey into being a wonderful teacher. And so you've got to find someone where there's a fit. Because when you sing, you're not just doing a mechanical thing. It's not the same as a lot of different instruments. It's you. It's your vocal cords, it's your body, but it's your soul, it's your mind, it's how you feel that day. And so you've got to have a sense of trust and connection with the teacher that you choose. And so what I see happening, because I'm an adjunct music instructor, and so I keep touch with my college students who go on from the 2-year college where I teach to other full-time music schools. And they didn't, until I started telling them, they didn't know to explore and to take lessons and to have a say and say, I accept, but I need to be in this person's studio. So they're just placed in a studio and they get the last choice sometimes because they're the freshmen, they're the youngest. So, and they don't know how to advocate for themselves. And so sometimes they just get placed into whoever's studio. And I don't mean to say that the schools don't give it thought. I'm sure that they do, but I really suggest that the singer does their homework and has a lesson and really feels some kind of connection with this person who's going to be a very important factor in their vocal health and their vocal development at this crucial time in your early 20s.
Right. The analogy that comes to my mind are the schools where, you know, the sports are really high level, and anyone who's being considered by a school to join a high level sports team, you know, they'll go for a practice, they'll meet the coach, they'll, you know, they go to campus, they get that sense of, you know, where is my best path? Where's my home base? Where do I fit in the best? So it sounds like it's almost the same process with voice and with music.
Or should be. Yeah. I mean, with sports, I think you see the talent really being wooed by the school, right?
Yeah.
And I don't see that so much with singers. Yeah. So as a singer, you've got to advocate for yourself and do your homework.
That's a huge tip that you just gave, you know, even before you get to college, being the leader of your own experience and carving your own path and asking for what you want, and not just, you know, waiting to be accepted, waiting to be placed. It's more about being proactive, even as a, you know, recent high school graduate, late teen, early 20s, mid 20s person, like really taking your education and career by the reins and driving it for yourself.
Yes. And there's something there as a very young singer. I didn't know how to do that. You know, I was very lucky that I had a wonderful voice teacher who gave me the advice, you know, it doesn't matter what school you go to. She went to Juilliard and she's extremely talented still. I mean, just wonderful voice. And she had some really tough experiences. The competition was so fierce that her roommate would erase or change the dates in my voice teacher's date book so that she didn't show up to auditions on the right date or time. It was that competitive. I don't know about you. I don't thrive with that kind of competition. I'm a really sensitive person. So, I mean, I'm a strong person, but I'm sensitive. That kind of stuff happens. And that's my other big piece of advice for pre-college, but during college, is that sense of competition can be, it's so punishing, you know, it can be so punishing. And I really, what I want for young singers is to find people and gather people that give you a sense of collaboration, because singing, when it feels collaborative, is magical. It's on the soul level. You get resonance, you hear overtones. I mean, these magical things happen. Singing, when it's competition, is ego singing. And it's easy to hurt yourself because you're going to be pushing, because you're going to be trying so hard to win that competition, to come out on top. So that's where I really advocate for people who are in college, who maybe it's not going the way they're expecting, maybe they're having a hard time, maybe they're having anxiety because of the competition, mentorship can give you a sense of that support and collaboration. And I wish I had had that, because I did have a lot of anxiety, and I did not thrive with the sense of competition that I felt in undergrad. Mm. It probably toughened me up a little bit. I'm not saying it's all bad. However, I think that if I had had a mentor, you know, someone 20 years older who had my back, who could talk to me about vocal issues as well as the politics that happen in academia. If say you got placed in a studio and this teacher is not doing you any favors vocally, it is difficult to navigate moving to another studio. I mean, having someone help you with that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. I don't want singers to feel alone. There is so much that is solitary, you know, learning your pieces, warming up every day, making your weird noises that you don't want to make around other people so that you can have your vocal hygiene practice. There is so much solitude and isolation, even though it seems like, oh, I'm a star, I'm on stage. So much discipline and work. And so to have that in combination with someone mentoring you while you go through college, it's priceless. And I want singers to know that they don't have to do it alone.
Yeah, that's one of the things that you're offering now. And the club is a component of that. So they have that daily connection and support. And yeah, I know for you, in your experience, we'll just touch on quickly, you told me that you didn't sing for 2 years after college because of your experience, and it like really just turned you off of singing altogether. It hurt your confidence.
It did. And I was very lucky. I had two very healthy vocal teachers, and I did feel supported by them. I think part of this is that I had unspoken expectations and I didn't know how to advocate for myself. Also, one of the things that really stressed me out was the skill level that you're expected to come into college with is there's usually a big gap between what you get in terms of theory, in terms of ear training, sight singing, what you get in high school and what you're expected to come into college with. So I, as a singer and not an instrumentalist, had a really hard time with my sight singing classes, my ear training classes. And so I do really wish that I had been mentored more to develop those skills. And also, I think coming from being a big fish in a small pond, you know, I had lots of solos, I had lots of performance experience. And I think that part of me was thinking that going to college meant that people would hear me sing, they would think I was wonderful, and they would just offer me opportunities. And it's really not how it happens in college. None of your professors are thinking that's their job, right? Their job is to train you on this very specific skill, theory or sight singing or, you know, your performance. So
where the education and career piece meet the how it translates into career later, you felt in your own experience was lacking a little bit.
Yes, yes. And I think in the classical world, in the performance world for vocalists, so much of undergrad is about opera and classical. And if you don't have that huge classical voice, I, for one, just felt like there weren't a lot of opportunities, and I didn't know where to go after that. Also, my voice, if I tried to sing over an orchestra every night, I would probably blow my voice out. So So I think there was something discouraging about that. You know, where does someone with the smaller but beautiful and moving voice fit in this world? They don't always. So knowing how to create your own path, ask questions of these amazing professors while you're there, that's really a skill that can be developed. But yes, I was discouraged after school. I did not know how to springboard from my college experience into a career that had to do with singing and music. I just didn't know how to do it. And I'm not blaming the school. I think a lot of that was me not knowing how to ask the right questions or advocate.
Yeah, so important. And I know we've been talking a lot about college, and we'll have to wrap up shortly, but let's talk about students, and you go into this way more in the workshop. And just to be clear, the workshop is for pre-college, college, and even post-college in the first couple of years, but also for students that either never went to college, or, you know, whether they wanted to or not, you know, some people just don't want to go to college too, right? So the workshop is for all of those folks and parents as well, or involved adults, because, you know, whether it's financial decisions or career decisions, oftentimes the parents or other adults are involved in that. But just quickly, I know when we were talking earlier, you gave some ideas on how somebody who's not going the traditional college route, how can they kind of assemble their own education and career path to give themselves like the various experiences and skills they need for a career?
Yes. I think with the technology that we have and the streaming that we can do, there are more opportunities than ever for a singer to build their own path and find their own way. There was a quote, Viggo Mortensen grew up around where I live, and I was at a Q&A at one of his movie premieres, and somebody had asked him, you know, about, you know, how can I have a big break, and how can I break into the music or movie industry? And Viggo Mortensen said, if you want to make films, make films. You can make films on your phone now. You know, what he said is, no one is stopping you from developing your artistic creativity and your body of work and your experience. And I think that's so important for singers to think about too. No one is stopping you. Is school great? Yeah, school is great. No one is stopping you from saying, well, I don't want to sing opera. I really like this style of song. I'm going to create a recital. No one's stopping you. I mean, now you don't even have to pay, you know, advertisers. You can write emails yourself and, you know, sell tickets. You can, you know, in COVID, you can stream a recital from your living room. Right. You know, I mean, there are so many things that you can do to give yourself experience, to get to know what you really want, to get to know what pieces your voice really shines, you know, when you're singing them. And no one is stopping you. College is not a gateway for you. And like I said before, I defy you to find a pop star who finished school. You know, they just worked on themselves, you know, and they got breaks, but because they had developed their sense of self-discipline, practice, you know, built their chops, all of that stuff, you know, they didn't need a traditional path. So, yeah. So
those are the kinds of things that, let's quickly touch on some of the programs and things that you have. You'll be sharing more about these in your workshop as well as diving more into the topics that we covered today. But so a couple of the things, the way you support your students in tackling all these issues is, number one, you have the Vocal Alchemy Club, and that's the piece you and I work on together. And basically, that's for any singer, you know, whether it's a, you know, student going to college, or, you know, anyone who just is interested in working on their voice. can come in and get some training, but also it's really about habit development. It's about developing a daily practice. It's about good vocal hygiene to protect the voice, all of those kinds of things. Can you talk about some of the other things that you might be covering in the club?
Yes. So there'll be videos so that you can take charge and learn what it takes for you to feel warmed up. So there'll be a library of videos. There'll be daily worksheets where you can track. I know not everyone is very interested in metrics, but until you really track your own practice habits, how long you're practicing, what you're practicing, don't knock them. Don't knock the metrics because they don't lie, you know? So the worksheets will help singers develop that artistic daily practice that really is necessary, because with the voice, it's different every day. And just like a plant, you can't just water a plant gallons and gallons and gallons once a month, right? You've got to, you know, every day, every other day. The voice is the same way. I mean, they are the vocal folds. Well, I don't want to get too detailed, but they need.
This is what the club is for. You're going to get into the details.
Yes.
But this is why, you know, whether it's somebody who's like, I like to do karaoke, for me, you know, if I want to improve that, the club is great for me. But if I'm a serious singer too, with a career path in mind, then it's great for that person. And you include that online club with your two other big programs. One is that college mentoring year where you're going to support the student who is in college, talking a lot about the things we've already covered in this interview. And then you also have a college alternative year, whether it's somebody who's taking a gap year or two and doesn't tend to go to school at some point, or somebody who's just decided college is not their path, you'll be working with them as well. So I know you're going to go into more detail on that in the workshop itself. I mean, basically the takeaway is so many lessons today that you shared and more that you'll be going in the workshop. And the big thing about the workshop is to get to talk to you, you know, to actually have the conversation, get the questions answered specific to the students. And that's a big part of it.
Yes, yes, it will be really interactive. And also what you get as part of the workshop is a mini lesson with me afterwards. So you can work on maybe a vocal issue, or you can also use that lesson to ask me questions. So you have access to me as a resource to help you make those really good decisions for yourself.
That's so wonderful. That's a really unique experience too. So Clancy, let's tell folks how they can find you. So number one, your main website is clancycox.com. And then if you're interested in signing up for this workshop, and this video is not on our workshop page, how you find it is in the description underneath this video will be the link to take you to the page with all the information, what the workshop covers in more detail, how to get your tickets, and all of that on that page. So look in the description underneath. And I have to say, it's been so wonderful working with you and developing your Vocal Alchemy Club. And I've learned so much about singing from you. And just, you know, these were issues that I didn't know existed. And it's so wonderful that you're creating this experience for students so that they can choose college from an informed place, and they're going in with eyes wide open, or that they know that there's other alternatives available to them if they can't go or don't want to go at this time. So Clancy, you're doing amazing work in the world, and I hope everybody watching goes to your workshop and gets to learn more and chat with you.
Thank you so much, Michelle. I hope so too.
All right, well, have a wonderful day.
You too.